Mr. Kinnock, you said this morning that you would begin to decommission Polaris as soon as you came into office were you to be elected Prime Minister, unless, you added, there were an immediate prospect of strategic negotiations, in which case you might consider putting Polaris into those negotiations. Isn't that a very bizarre way of treating negotiations, saying, in effect, you'll go along with them so long as they suit your timetable?
No, that isn't what I was saying at all, and it's not in the least bit bizarre. We've always made it very clear that if there were multilateral negotiations underway, we'd want to be part of that process in order to secure nuclear build-down and the removal of nuclear weapons. We've demonstrated that we weren't just saying that, but we meant it in the most direct and realistic fashion by saying that as long as the INF negotiations go on and there's a prospect of there being removal of intermediate nuclear forces on both sides, east and west, then we wouldn't be seeking the removal of crews during that period. If it were the case, as I went into some length pointing out this morning, that the Reykjavik agenda of the reduction of strategic arms was to be continued with, and there was a quick and early prospect of that being undertaken, we would take the same attitude towards Polaris. But I also said that sadly, that is not the case. The prospect of strategic arms reduction is on the other side of the horizon, so our position is that we proceed with the decommissioning of Polaris.
But isn't that an attitude to negotiations, rather like the shopkeeper? The customer comes in and says, I'd like that. You say, yes, well, you can pay for it. If you don't pay for it, I'll give it to you.
No, it isn't that in the least. The Polaris system is obsolescent. That's why the government is buying the Trident system. In the meantime, to sustain that Polaris system costs £500 million a year, and the government is spending £1 billion a year on the purchase of Trident. Our argument is, and it's a very forceful argument, that it would be much better for the defence of our country and for our contribution to NATO to use those resources in the modernisation and provision of our army, our navy and our air force. And just remember that the alternative to using those resources for those purposes of the army, navy and air force is to see the rundown which the Tories have built into their defence white paper and guaranteed a 30% cut in support for the army, navy and air force over the forthcoming years. That makes us more dependent on nuclear weapons. It doesn't add to our security or defence at all. It's a misuse of resources, and that's why we say, let us save the Polaris money, let us save the Trident money, let us use it for our army, navy and air force.
But if you are to take negotiations seriously, you go into them presumably on the assumption that they're quite complicated, they may take a long time. You don't go into them and say, into negotiations saying, well, if they work, we'll be jolly delighted. If they don't work, well, it doesn't matter very much, we'll get rid of the weapons in any case. And you are saying that, can I just finish the question? You're saying that both in the case of Polaris.
You're putting words in my mouth, so I'm going to stop you there.
I'm asking,
before you do put the words in my mouth.
No, I'd be very grateful if I could just finish my question.
About negotiations that are underway, we're part of the process of encouraging those negotiations. There is nothing in the least bit inconsistent with that, because we think there is a realistic prospect, as there most certainly is, of securing the withdrawal of intermediate nuclear forces, of which crews are a part.
But if you don't get successful negotiations, your position is if the negotiations fail, in the case of Polaris were that to happen, but much more directly in the case of crews, then the American weapons go in any case.
Oh, we've made that very clear for a very long time.
But what sense of negotiations is that?
Well, there's a very strong sense that cruise weapons have never enjoyed the majority support of the British people. They don't enhance our security. They're weapons of first use, and the British people, even more than they're against the installation of cruise weapons, are against the commencement of nuclear war by Britain, or from Britain. So consequently, all the force of argument is there. But don't forget, we're talking now against the background, not of a single act of just getting rid of one weapon system, but of negotiations realistically proceeding to be pursued. President Reagan said yesterday he's hoping to talk to Mr. Gorbachev in what he called the fall, realistically proceeding apace, and we can ensure that the cruise goes at the same time as the Pershing 2s and at the same time of the SS-20s, and the whole of Europe will be the safer for that.
But these are negotiations in which, if your policy prevailed, of unilateralism would not have been relevant in any case.
Well, I think that the negotiations would have gone on, because the misfortune is, of course, that we are not part of those negotiations. Our acceptance of cruise hasn't bought us a ticket to the negotiating chamber. Our ownership of Polaris hasn't won us entrance into the disarmament negotiations. So what we are seeing is those negotiations conducted above our heads in any case, and I welcome them, because the superpowers who are actually in control of the nuclear weapons East and West are seriously engaging, contrary to the desires of Mrs. Thatcher, incidentally, but seriously engaging in the process of nuclear weapons withdrawal and build-down. On
during the
INS,
process,
certainly now, and certainly in Reykjavik too, they both expressed the strong desire and a strategy for doing it with strategic weapons.
You have said that Cruz and Pershing will depart by the end of your next term of office were you to be elected, but you don't put any timetable on the negotiations over Cruz. What are the point of consulting with the Americans if the outcome of those consultations is a foregone conclusion?
Well, the consultation with the Americans is about the Poseidon bases in Scotland, at Holyloch, and about the different role for the F-111s. We made that very clear. And incidentally, in the very technical act of the withdrawal of Cruz, it will be necessary to communicate that decision to the United States of America and undertake those consultations. Now, the point of consultation is that we're not going to do what the French did and the De Gaulle. We're not going to do what the Canadians did and the Pierre Trudeau. Pierre Trudeau's Canada made the decision not to accommodate United States or anybody else's nuclear missiles without going through any extended period of consultation. Charles de Gaulle tossed NATO and everybody else out as a very direct act without any form of consultation. We are allies, good allies. We won't go about it in that fashion. But we do set the objectives and we will obtain those objectives.
In the event of a nuclear threat against Britain, you've said that you wouldn't ask for the support of the what's called the nuclear umbrella. If it were offered, or if it looked as if it was going to be used, would you seek to reject the nuclear umbrella?
What I've said is that the US president, whoever the US president was, would only take a decision to commence or to respond to nuclear war according to United States priorities.
Well, supposing he decided to respond, what would you do then?
United States priorities. If I can just finish the point. Now, it may be that those priorities extended for some reason to committing themselves to nuclear war as a consequence of events in Europe. But it's a horrific decision. It isn't F.D. Roosevelt saying to Winston Churchill that he wanted to be in, then the Japanese conducting the act of aggression at Pearl Harbor, and then the agreement to come into the Second World War. It is actually, by engagement in that nuclear war, inviting the obliteration of very considerable parts of the United States homeland. That's why it is reasonable to assume, fair to assume, that even our strongest allies, the United States of America, would only take a decision to use their nuclear weapons, either for themselves or on behalf of others, according to their own priorities.
And Mr. Healy said yesterday, if I could put you to this point, Mr. Healy said yesterday that he was...
Or suggestion from anybody else.
Mr. Healy said yesterday, when he was asked this question, he was asked, would he expect the USA to come galloping to Britain's aid if the Soviets tried nuclear blackmail? His answer was very brief and to the point. He said, certainly. Do you share that view, that they would
come
galloping?
What he went on to say was, to quote, the only precedent we have, and that was at the time of Suez, of high tension, and of the declaration by the United States President Eisenhower that they would be willing to use. On the basis of that precedent, I think that Dennis was describing the facts of life. I think they're widely acknowledged, and I don't think anyone deviates. Still, it was on the basis of Truman's assessment, Eisenhower's assessment, of what American interests were, what American priorities were. And I don't deviate from that at all. I think that continues to be the realistic condition.
But you would hope that they would not come galloping to the rescue.
I think everybody is going to hope that nobody is going to inaugurate nuclear war, aren't they?
Mr. Healy said, if I may put to you, two months ago, he expressed that strong hope.
So that's not unique, is it?
Yes, but under those circumstances, you would hope they wouldn't come to the rescue. Mr. Healy,
with nuclear weapons.
No,
you're putting words in my mouth.
I'm sorry, I must have misunderstood.
You're using the phrase, come to the rescue.
That's the phrase that was there with Mr. Healy.
I know, but that isn't the condition that we're in, is it? Of coming to the rescue with an act that, if it was fulfilled, would obliterate the continent of Europe. I think that you could describe it as a lot of things, but obliteration being a form of rescue isn't. Now, we're talking about something different. The analogy, the precedent in respect of Suez, the only other time when such a situation has arisen is one in which the United States of America made the offer that they would be prepared to engage if certain things occurred. Now, that, according to American perceptions, priorities, and interests, is a possibility for the future. But I'm telling you, it's a hypothetical scenario, especially against the background of what is actually occurring now. You do realize, don't you,
I would
that
like
the superpowers
to move on if I could,
are seriously engaged
you've
in
said
trying
this,
to get
have,
rid of
you have, you have, you have indeed been
yes,
saying that.
Yes, but it isn't said by a lot of other people.
Well, it's, I think you've said it a number of times, even in this interview. Mr. Healy also said, and it's an important point that he made in an interview, in an article, so long as the Soviet Union has nuclear weapons, there have to be nuclear weapons somewhere in NATO to deter the Soviet Union from using nuclear
statement
weapons.
Statement of the facts of life.
No, I'm sorry.
It's a statement of the facts of life. Look.
He says there have to be, but that is surely an approval
statement of the fact of life. The fact of life is this. We are members of NATO. NATO is a nuclear alliance.
But you want to get rid of those nuclear weapons, Mr.
Of course, and so does President Reagan, and so does Mr. Gorbachev.
Mr. Healy is saying only if it's multilateral, only if both sides get rid of them.
I'll answer the point.
Okay.
But you prolong my answer by the interjection. What I'm saying to you is...
just trying to deal with the point quite briefly. It's quite a simple point.
It isn't just I want to change the status and strategy of NATO. What do you think President Reagan means when he says he wants the denuclearization of Europe? That's his phrase, not mine. And he's used it repeatedly, used it again this week. Now then, on the point that you raise about...
I'd like to go on to your economic program as soon as you've got the moment.
On the point you raise about Dennis, as I said... NATO is a nuclear alliance. We are part of that alliance. We hope to encourage a change in the strategy. So, as I said, does President Reagan. Until that occurs, we remain part of that alliance very firmly with the obligations that go with it in terms of the commitment that we have to NATO, a commitment that takes 95% of our defense budget, which we, the Labour Party, will sustain in government.
To move on, how are you going to raise the money that you need, 3.6 billion I think it's estimated at, to realise your anti-poverty programme of raising pensions, child benefits and so on? How is that money to be raised?
By imposing taxes on that 5%, that richest 5% in our society, who have benefited in each year of Mrs. Thatcher's government to the tune of 3.6 billion. Just to spell out very briefly what that means, someone on £200,000 a year, an individual, has over that 8 years got £210,000 in tax concessions. Somebody on £100,000 over that 8 years has got £74,000 in tax concessions. We think that people should pay their dues, and we think that the broadest backs should bear the greatest burden. And consequently, we install a tax regime affecting only those people on those very high incomes, and the consequence is to raise the kind of money that we need to pay £5 extra to a single pensioner and £8 extra to a married couple.
Can you be more precise about how you intend to raise that money? You say it's from the 5% better off. How are you going to claw it back from them?
Well,
what form will that take?
Yes, we know how we do it, but there's a tiny problem, isn't there, of me announcing exactly the kind of tax schedules and regimes that we'll introduce, because there's some possibility that looking in will be people who will want to make arrangements so that they don't have to meet their full tax bill. And consequently, therefore, they have the assurance first we're not going to restore the 83% rate, but we are going to raise taxes on them. They know it. And the consequence will be to produce, over a 12-month period, 3.6 billion, which we want to transfer directly to the poor in our country. Now there are 2 million more of them, including a lot of children, than there were when Mrs. Thatcher came into office.
Understood. Can you then reassure those who are at a lower level of income that you won't, for instance, abolish the ceiling on national insurance contributions to raise this money, which would affect people under 15,000?
We're going, and we've said clearly for a long time, to abolish the ceiling on national insurance contributions.
That affects people on under 15,000 a year, doesn't it?
15,000. Yes. Let's say somebody on 17,000, liable over that extra 2,000 for national insurance contributions, would be paying additional pennies a week. We're not talking about a huge tax burden. But we also believe, of course, that it's quite sensible not to have an unfair system where the person on £14,999 a year pays as much in national insurance as the person on £30,000 a year. And that's why it's only fair to raise that lid. Now,
Do you intend,
is,
can I just come
under
to one of
15,000, of course, has no extra bill to pay.
Right. You don't say in the manifesto, and perhaps you could clarify, whether you intend to restrict interest relief on mortgages to help raise this money to the basic rate of tax.
We make it very clear in the manifesto.
I read through the manifesto. You don't mention interest rates on mortgages.
Yes, we do. I can find the page for you.
Interest, we won't go into that now.
Interest relief at standard rate will remain. I think I quote the precise words. And that's what's actually going to happen. Now, it'll save us around about £350 million a year because the bulk of the relief, of course, goes to people who are on standard rate. But it then does provide from those on much higher incomes, paying the higher levels of taxation, people on 35, 40,000, 50 and more thousand pounds a year, they lose relief between them. It doesn't amount to a great deal, but it does give us additional resources to plough into housing and the improvement of our stock in Britain, both public, obviously, and to some extent private with improvement grants.
To finance your jobs programme to reduce the unemployment accused by a million over 2 years. You're going to borrow money, some £3.5 billion, and you're also going to reverse the two penny tax cut in the last budget. Isn't that perhaps that prospect of losing that tax cut one of the reasons why the Tories preserve their comfortable lead? That people say, yes, we are very, very concerned about the unemployed, but in the end, we don't want to surrender that money that we've just got in our pockets.
Well, let's take the 2 points. First, the 2p tax cut. Had I not bumped into a chap today in Gravesend, I would have gone into a detailed explanation, but I think he put his foot on it, his finger on it, absolutely. We were talking about Gravesend Hospital, and there is great public agitation to try and resist the closure of the hospital. And he actually volunteered to me the view that I'd rather not have the 2p tax cut and keep the hospital, because if I get 2-3 quid a week out of the tax cut, says he, man, employed, good job, decent pay, I still won't be able to buy a hospital bed. And this is the priority that really does reflect itself in the British people. Having tax cuts is lovely. Everybody likes tax cuts. But when it involves the underfunding of the health service, not paying decent pensions, not providing sufficient books in school for the children, it is a very, very expensive tax cut. Because even if you've got the tax cut, you're not going to be able to provide those things for yourself out of that shaving of relief that you're able to get as a result of that tax cut.
You recognise in the manifesto the importance of controlling inflation. What is a satisfactory level of inflation, given your attack this morning on the government for the fact that British inflation at the moment is higher than the level of our competitors? Do you expect to reduce inflation?
Nil inflation would be very good. But the first thing to be recognised...
What will you settle for?
Well, I'm not going to pluck a thing. You asked a serious question and give you a serious answer. I'm not going to go around guessing figures.
Is it too high at the moment?
What the estimate that we've had... Well, it's always too high, isn't it? But the estimate that we've had on the basis of our economic programme is that it will be no greater than it will be under the current government. Now, let's go to the roots of inflation.
That means that your policy is going to be predicated on the assumption that you can maintain inflation at 4%.
Between 4 and 5%, which is where it is now.
Now, at the moment, the wages are running at 7% at the moment. Do you regard that as too high?
The important thing about wages is what proportion they constitute of final costs. There are wage rises in other countries that constitute less than 3%, which are much bigger than the wage rises of 7% in this country, which is why I want to get to the point. Where does inflation come from? Most of our inflation, actually, is imported inflation. It comes from movements in commodity and import prices and the effects of our currency. Now, this government has not been able to counteract that. And what we want to do by improving our production, by investing, by training, by getting a greater quantity and quality of goods, by making our way in the world, is actually to have more impact. And that's the best way to reduce production costs and to contain inflation. Secondly, so far as domestic inflation is concerned, there is a condition in which you can have too much money chasing too few goods. There are two options. One, you cut back on all the money and depress the economy, or two, you improve the supply of goods, preferably from your domestic sources. That, again, is what we're engaged in. Now, the other point is this. So far as wages are a part of inflation, the government has direct or indirect responsibility for employing about 7 million people. And the people in that area know that our priority is fighting unemployment and fighting poverty by the improvement in pensions and so on, and also by introducing a minimum wage. They know that's the priority, and they know there is no money coming out of both pockets. That's always been understood.
But it's so often been the priority
to fulfill.
It's often been the priority of Labour governments.
We're not
hasn't
going
it?
To be spraying the money around, yeah, obviously.
It's been the policy before of Labour governments to redistribute wealth. What happens when the private sector workers, when there is increased demand, when you're putting $10 billion a year into the economy, say, we want a bigger share of this, and their wage rates go accelerating away.
They negotiated then, with their employers.
Yes, and
we've
say
had
they go,
and
say, just let me finish the point, please. They go accelerating away. The public sector, over which you have control, then says, hey, we want to catch up. What do you say to them? Isn't that the recipe for the next winter of discontent?
No, it's what an employer says, and that's why I emphasize that we have direct and indirect obligations for people. An employer says, this is what can be afforded. Now, we have been required and have gladly accepted the priorities of fighting unemployment, which strengthens people in the labour market, both people in work and people out of work, of fighting poverty, of paying higher pensions. And what we make clear right at the outset is there aren't limitless resources to meet those obligations and significant large increases in other areas, even though I could certainly justify the allocation of additional resources because people are not earning high incomes. But that's the obligation, too, of employers in other spheres. And if they are prepared to diminish their competitiveness by allowing that drift to take place, well, it's on their own heads. I think people have got a different attitude. And what you'll find is that most trade unionists negotiate on the basis of the realistic cost margins.
You say that you will guarantee what you call in the manifesto the essential legal freedom of workers and their unions to organise effective industrial action.
Yeah.
At the moment, the code suggests that the appropriate picket size is 6, and it is...
That's the TUC code,
And it is illegal, it's an offence at least, to picket beyond your place at work. Do you intend that picket sizes under your government should remain at that guideline, and do you intend to ensure that pickets should be not allowed to picket beyond their place of work?
Well, since the TUC guideline was established in the life of a Labour government, that's the guideline that everybody will continue to operate. Secondly, as far as secondary picketing is concerned, in pursuit of a trade dispute, in connection with that trade dispute, the same kind of right that workers enjoyed for 70 years in this country is a right that should be enjoyed in order to be able to do that. And the reason why it was awarded...
Does that mean you do approve of secondary picketing being restored or not?
I think I made that pretty clear.
Secondary picketing be reintroduced
was for 70 years. And the person who permitted it in the first place was Winston Churchill, then Home Secretary, who said that because of the difference in the balance of power between workers and employers, it was necessary to be able to accept that right in order to have some equity in the industrial relations situation.
Under your
of
proposals,
course,
too,
it's
on
a matter
industrial
of low
relations.
Incidence. It very rarely happens, but people should be able to exercise that right.
That people, viewers, will be interested in that.
In
your proposals also, do you intend that it would be impossible for a union to call a strike without a strike ballot, and that no leader of a union could be appointed without a secret ballot?
In the union constitution, the provision is made for secret ballots in respect of elections, in respect of strikes and all the rest of it.
Required?
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. Like Rule 41 of the NUM rulebook. And rules in my trade union.
So Mr. Scargill, for instance, wouldn't be able to, under your proposals, call a strike without a ballot.
I'll answer that point absolutely. And that constitution is a contract with each individual member of the union. Now, in the event of an individual member of a union feeling that that contract has been breached, not honoured, then under our proposals, that individual will be able to go to an industrial tribunal, and without going through the massive expense of the way in which people brought actions, not under conservative legislation, but under common law stretching back hundreds of years that has always applied in this country, without going through that massive expense, be able to get their dues under the terms of the contract that they have with the union, the constitution of the union.
But now, the onus would now reside.
You raised the NUM. That's certainly the case. If that rule was not fulfilled, individual members of the union could go to the tribunal and see that the rule was fulfilled.
But
in
it
a
would
ballot
depend now. The onus would rest on the individual member
well,
of the
now.
Union
it does
to say, I want a ballot.
But it does now.
Right.
Can it doesn't always have. It's under common law. It's nothing to do with the Tory legislation.
Can I move on, finally? Do you extend a welcome to all your candidates who might enter Parliament if you emerge with an overall majority?
Well, of course, I want them to win the elections.
You welcome Pat Wall, David Nelling?
There is no man
Terry
standing
Fields?
For Parliament who has been more thoroughly assessed and subjected to questioning than Pat Wall. And in the terms of the Labour Party Constitution, he satisfied the questions of the National Executive Committee unanimously.
What do you make of this statement, if I can quote it to you? Irrespective of whether or not we win the election, there's a major struggle coming about the kind of Labour Party we want to see.
I read the piece and you got it out of context.
I've read the piece very carefully and I don't think
well,
I have.
The rest of it then.
I haven't got
and,
it all here.
Ken Livingstone was completely at liberty to write that. I
do
think
you believe
that
he's right in saying there's a major struggle coming about, the kind of party we want?
Of course there isn't a major struggle coming about.
He's wrong.
Don't you remember the history of the last 3.5 years? Do you really think that the way in which we've conducted the party, all of us, the whole party, in the last 3.5 years means that we are going to luxuriate in some kind of tussle following the election. We will win that election, and the minds of everyone and the activities of everyone will be concentrated on getting our country back to work, of fighting poverty, of increasing efficiency and increasing justice, of getting us out of this balance of payments deficit recorded yet again today. That's the kind of mess this government has got us into, despite having £60 billion worth of oil revenues.
You don't
that's,
think you don't
that's
think,
the task in hand.
You don't
that's
think the
electorate
might say that given that internecine warfare of the last few years suspended for this election, that even
it's
though we would like to have Mr. Kinnock, even though we would like to have Mr. Kinnock as our next door neighbour, we can't trust that he is going to be free to lead this country in the way it needs to be led.
What do you describe
and therefore
as
we
the,
won't put him into
what
number
you
10.
Describe as the internecine warfare is suspended for the duration, not for the election.
Mr. Kinnock, thank you
thank
very
you.
Much indeed.